Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We're going to begin our service this morning. If you would, prepare your hearts to worship. Amen. Amen. Reminded in John chapter 4, there was a woman that Jesus talked to, and she was asking him about worship. And Jesus said to this woman, there's a time coming, neither here nor there, but true worshipers would worship him in spirit and truth. Amen. Jesus was talking about you and I. Look at your neighbor and say, he was talking about you. For us to worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. If you would, stand with me this morning. We're going to prepare our hearts for worship. I want to remind you, right back in the back, our elders will be back there. Bill and Melanie Milliner. Don and Lori Hansen will be in the back. If you need prayer for any reason, they would love to pray with you. Also, we have communion right back in the back. If you want to take communion with your family, you're free to do that. I want to give a quick shout out. Miss Kaylee, Katie Wormley is back in the building this morning. Everybody say hi to Katie. We love you so much. Hey, prepare your hearts to worship. Let's go there. Father, thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for your son, Jesus. We celebrate you. We bless you. We honor you, God. Have your way this morning. We rejoice that we can meet in your name. And we thank you for all you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The light that leads us like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. Sing it out. We will sing, sing, sing and make music with the heavens. We will sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. You are the love. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us like a fire burning.
We will sing.
We will sing, sing, sing and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. your name on high, Jesus. I'm making melody in my heart to you. I'm making melody in my heart to you. Pouring out your praise with everything within. I'm making melody in my heart to you. I'm making melody in my heart to you. Yours will always be the song I love to sing. And how can hearts not love your name? And how can souls not sing your name?
Your name on high. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. Lord, we praise you for your grace towards us. We thank you for the cross this morning. Father, no matter what is going on in our lives, no matter our circumstances, Jesus, we just lift praise to your name.
You are the one who is seated on the throne. The elders, they bow before you. The angels, they bow before you. So, Lord, we praise you this morning in Jesus' name. all that you are. You're worthy of it all. For all that you gave for us, for from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory, for from you are. The incense is the prayers of the saints and worship. The Bible describes that worship will arise to his throne from all the nations of the earth, not just here in this place, but in Africa, in Asia, in South America, every tongue, tribe, and people. So let's sing this out as a prayer that day and night all across the globe, incense would arise to his name, that a song would arise to his name. Ready, sing this out.
Oh, day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
Pressing in me that God wants us to remember that no matter what our story has been in the past, no matter what your choices have been in the past, that when you accept Him as Lord and Savior, a new story begins. And sometimes when we're new in that, we don't know what to proclaim. We don't know what to say. But always remember that your story is that you are the heir of salvation, that you've been purchased by the blood of Jesus, that you are born in His Spirit, and you've been washed in His blood. And when you don't know what to say, just remember, that is your story, and that is your song. Blessed assurance. Come on, sing it. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born in his spirit, washed in blessed, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his in his love. Is that your story today? Raising my story.
This is my story.
Corinthians 15, the Apostle Paul is writing to the church in Corinth, and he says this: Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. Earthly people are like earthly man, and heavenly people are like the heavenly man. Just as we are now like the earthly man, we will someday be like the heavenly man. Somebody say amen. What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, the scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. I said, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thanks and thank God, He gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, this last word, be strong, immovable, always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Come on, amen. Come on, lift your hands, amen. Come on, let's just clap. God, we thank you right now that death has lost its sting, that we have been transferred out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, that we can get excited and celebrate Jesus because you are risen King and Savior, and you have overcome the world so we can overcome the world. So we rejoice in that truth, that our God is risen and He is alive. So let us be immovable, always work enthusiastically for the Lord. Nothing we do for Him is ever useless. Father, we thank you for this time. We honor you, God. We celebrate you, Jesus. Thank you for who you are. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, the victorious said, amen. Come on, you guys are awesome this morning. Come on, Lord, we love you. We praise you. Man, it's good in here. Look at your neighbor and say, it's good. It's just going to get better. Before you're seated, if you would shake someone's hand, greet your neighbor. Amen, amen, amen. It's awesome. So good when God's people get together. You know that? You guys know that? It's good when we get together. Somebody say together. We're better together. It's good when we get together, amen. Thank God for the common denominator, which is Jesus. Amen. We're going to make our way back to our seats. I know it's so good right now. It's so good. It's getting prime for Pastor Chris and the Word. Priming up. Amen. God is so good this morning. God is good. Oh, no. We forgot who we were. Let me try that one more time. God is good. And all the time. So God is good. Look at your neighbor and say, all the time. Look at your other neighbor and say, and all the time. God is good. Amen. It's good to be reminded that God is good. Amen. Our city, many of our loved ones and friends are going through it with all the flooding and things that are going on. We must remind ourselves of the goodness of God. Amen. Thank God for the body of Christ. When we're struggling, we're going through it, we can look across the way and have a neighbor, have a brother, a sister to remind us of the goodness and the mercy and the grace of God. Amen. When the news cameras leave, and they're leaving, and all the hype is dying down, then it is, we, the body of Christ, step up and rise up and love on our neighbor and our community and remind them of the goodness of God. Amen? Amen. God bless you this morning. So glad to be with you this morning. I'm Pastor Jermaine Stewart. I'm on staff here with Pastor Chris and the team. We want to welcome you on behalf of our church, our elders, a body of leaders. We want to welcome you here this morning. So glad you chose to spend your Sunday with us. Thank God for sunshine. Amen. I'm like, Lord, please keep it coming. Keep it coming. Keep it coming. Help me, somebody. I need some sunshine on a cloudy day. Anyway, sounds like a song. But yeah, so glad for the sunshine. Thank God for changing of seasons. Amen. Amen. If you're here with us this morning and you are a guest, we want to welcome you here at Emmanuel Fellowship. We are so glad that you are here. There is a yellow card in the seat back pocket in front of you. If you would take that card out and fill it out in its entirety. And once our service concludes, myself along with members of our team will be right back here in our Welcome Center. We would love the opportunity to meet with you, to shake your hand. We have a gift for you as a token of our appreciation for you being with us this morning. Can we get up for our guests this morning? We love people. We love you. If you are here and you are a guest, stop by and see us. We want to shake your hand. Don't just leave. Stop by and see us. We want to shake your hand, hug your neck, make you all uncomfortable in Jesus. I'm just joking. I'm just playing. It's awkward, but it's all right. We love you. And so, amen. So glad to be with you this morning. One announcement is we're having prayer. Somebody say prayer. A praying church is a powerful church. I keep saying that over and over. A praying family is a powerful family. The enemy wants to get us to quit praying. We just said it in the song. The incense that Isaac reminded us as we're is the prayers of the saints. That's the incense of God. It's the aroma to God. When we pray and gather in his name, it's a sweet-smelling aroma to him. When our children pray, even though their prayers are little. I had Asher pray over my baby daughter, Alika Brienne, last night. He said, Lord, thank you for Alika. Thank you that she's cute. Thank you for giving her to us. We thank you for her in Jesus' name. Amen. That was it. But you know what? His prayer is powerful. Somebody say powerful. Your prayers are powerful. There are no puny prayers. The only puny prayers are those that aren't prayed. Unprayed prayers are puny, but even a weak prayer is powerful because if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, the Bible says we can move mountains. There ain't no puny prayers. So could you join us tonight for 1 hour? Somebody say 1 hour. It's our power hour. We're going to pray for 1 hour. We're going to pray for our community. We're going to pray for our school. We're going to pray for our state. We're going to pray for our nation. The answer to our problems is not found in a political party. It's found in Jesus Christ, the risen King. And we need him to come together to help us build bridges and not walls, to build bridges to come together and connect. And it's only going to happen in prayer first. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, that's me, my wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Our land needs healing, and it starts with you and I looking in the mirror and saying, God, start with me. Amen? So tonight, 6 o'clock p.m., 6 to 7, we're going to hit it hard for Jesus. It's going to be awesome. Bring someone. We would love to pray with you. Ushers, make your way to the front. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings at this time. If you're here, you're not prepared to give, you can do it. Reels, it's very simple. Go online. Go to emmanuelfellowship.com. You'll see the giving tab. Click that giving tab. It'll ask you for some information to fill in your name, your card number. It's safe and secure for the whole family. It's safe and secure. No one's going to get your information. And with a few clicks, you can give this morning and partner with us to help us advance the kingdom of God in the earth. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time together. It is good to gather in your name. I thank you for my brothers and sisters that are here, that aren't like me, that are different. God is so good. It's so beautiful. We thank you for the name of Jesus that brings us all together, that our God is not some idol. He is living and powerful. You are alive. And God, as we give today, would you bless the gift and the giver? Bless every home represented. God, use these gifts, God, to further your kingdom. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. If you would look to the screens for a few more announcements.
Good morning, Emmanuel. My name is Patty, and before we continue on with our service, I have a few announcements for you. Next Sunday, April 14th, we will be having a grab-and-go potato bar hosted by our own Student Ministries Department. They're going to be raising funds for their Youth America summer camp trip in July. More details are in your bulletin. Last week, you might remember that Pastor Chris mentioned that the staff was going to be volunteering with Omaha Rapid Response. Well, we'll be doing that this coming Tuesday, April 9th. We invite you to join us. Please call the church office or just meet us at Menards in Elkhorn at 8 a.m. on Tuesday morning. On April 28th, we will be taking our faith offering. Our faith offering is above and beyond our normal tithe, and we use this money to support outreaches or other ministries that we support. This particular faith offering will be going towards our annual block party. Our annual block party is not in our normal budget, so it depends on our generous donations during this faith offering for us to be able to do all the wonderful things we did last year. It was so awesome to be able to love on our neighbors. We hope you will prayerfully consider what the Lord would ask you to give towards this event. Thank you. That's all the announcements I have for you this morning. Be sure to check out the bulletin and our website for further information. Make sure that you follow us on Instagram and like us on Facebook. Now, let's continue on with our service.
Awesome, awesome. Well, good morning, everyone. Are you glad to be here? Well, we're glad you're here, and the Lord is here with us also, so it's a beautiful day. And when you go out these doors in a little bit, you're going to be greeted by Mr. Sunshine. So it's even better in every way. So I think someone says it's going to be 70 today, so I'm like, thank you, Jesus. Can you tell who the Southern people are in the house? Say hello. Yeah, we're okay, we're okay. Hey, we're going to release our Mighty Warriors, our children, kindergarten through fifth grade at this time, right over here to my left, to Rachel. Everybody say, hey, Rachel. All right, let's give it up for the kids as they go. Come on, we love Next Generation around here. Awesome. Awesome, awesome. Hey, but if you have your Bible, and I know that you do, turn to 2 Samuel chapter 6. We'll go there in just a moment. Believe it or not, I want to remind you that Easter is only two Sundays away. And it just, you know, it's surprising to me that we're even in the month of April. But I'm very thankful that we're in the month of April, weather-wise. But time is just a-flying. And so in 2 weeks is Easter Sunday. So I want to encourage you. We're going to have a special service that day as we celebrate our risen Lord. And it is going to be a celebration. Amen. Because he is not in the grave. He is alive and well, living in us. Amen? And so that is worth celebrating. This is a beautiful cross we ride over here, but Jesus is not on the cross. All right? I have a lot of my Catholic friends, and I bless them, and I love them, and they're my friends. But they'll have Jesus on the cross. Jesus is not on the cross. I know what it's representing, but he's not on the cross. He is risen. He is alive, and his spirit is in us. Amen? We're going to look at that this morning. And talk about that for a few minutes. So Easter is April 21st. Besides Christmas Eve is the one day of the week, one day of the year that almost everybody in some way, fashion, or form will visit a church. And besides Christmas Eve, it is also Easter Sunday. And so I want to encourage you to invite your neighbors. We've invited both our neighbors to join us. And all they can say is no, or they might just say yes. Your coworkers, your friends, or that divine appointment at Starbucks or wherever you are at that the Lord shows you someone. You never know. Next week, we're going to, do we have the cards here? Oh, great. We have the invite cards right here. So I was thinking it was next week, so I apologize. I was off for the week, so I'm kind of off a little bit. So our ushers are going to pass these invite cards out. These are twofold. Number one, pray. Somebody say pray. And number two, give it away. All right, that kind of rhymes a little bit. Pray and give it away. So you don't want to hold on this card long. You want to give it to someone, bless someone with it, and say, hey, I would love for you to join me for Easter. I know last year, even this past Christmas Eve, some people picked people up and brought them, and some people met them here in the parking lot. And so, again, Easter is a wonderful Sunday that will celebrate our Lord. We're going to have a special choir song and different things going on. But more than anything, it's a special day because we celebrate Jesus. Amen? And his risen and him being risen. But also every day, we should be celebrating Jesus. For sure. All right, so take those, pray, and then give it away. Somebody say pray. Give it away. Speaking of prayer, I just want to echo Pastor Jermaine. We totally recognize and realize that a Sunday night prayer service once a month is probably inconvenient for all of us here. We recognize that. But I also know that prayer in itself can be inconvenient if you're going to seek God. And I want to say this in love.
I think I say everything in love, but if we have more people come to a business meeting than a prayer meeting, something's wrong. I'll say that again. If we have more people that come to a business meeting than a prayer meeting, something's off somewhere. And so I want to encourage us to be a church that first and foremost seeks the face of God individually and corporately. Amen? And that we go there together. I mean, literally, it's once a month, 1 hour. I just want to encourage you. And no one ever going to put a microphone in your face. Most people are usually asked beforehand to pray. We get in small groups sometimes. Sometimes we don't. We just kind of go with the Holy Spirit and this worship together. It flies by. It flies by. But I want to encourage you. And everybody can't make everything, I understand. But make prayer a priority in your individual life. And we're definitely going to be a people that make prayer a priority in this house. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your word. And I'm asking in Jesus' name now, Lord, that you would help me be able to communicate what you've been talking to me about for the last couple weeks. Lord, I'm nervous in a way because I want to say what you've told me to say. So I just ask, as we prayed yesterday and I prayed this morning, that Chris would just step back and you would step up and speak through me. Because I know, Lord, this is a word from you. We love you, Jesus, and we praise you, and we thank you. Holy Spirit, speak to us. In your name we pray, and everybody said, amen. I do want you to know I am by myself this morning. The Lord, of course, is with me, and I'm with you lovely people. But my wife and daughter were suffering all week in Texas in 84-degree weather. I think we might have a couple of pictures. This is one part of their suffering with the blue bonnets. If anybody knows my wife, she needed to be in the blue bonnets. And every time we go to Texas, she makes us pull over and take a picture in the beautiful Texas blue bonnets, which are gorgeous, not as gorgeous as the two girls right there in front of you. And then they really suffered here yesterday. That's some crazy place. I don't understand it all, but all women find this magnetic pulse of pulling them there. And hopefully we're not broke. All right, so they'll be on their way back. Lisa needed some mom time. Lisa's mom needed some, come on, you know it, parent time. And so she needed a good break. And she's been filling in as our worship leader as Katie's been on baby leave. And of course, Lisa works another full-time job. So she's been doing two jobs for a while. So she needed a good break. So I got her out of here. I said, get out of here. Go see your mama. And then she left me with two boys all week. I'm exhausted. I'm fried. But we had a good time. Almost killed them a couple times, but that's okay. I love them. Hey, we're in the series Running on Empty, and these are the last two messages before it that leads us right up to Easter. And we'll culminate all this next Sunday. And we've been looking at addressing this subject of running on empty through the Bible, of course, looking at through the lens of the biblical lens, but we've also been talking realistically about why do we find ourselves many times in life empty? Because honestly, empty in Christianity is an oxymoron in my book. Let me say that again. Empty in Christianity is an oxymoron. It's completely opposites. When you ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, you are filled with the Holy Spirit. But as we know in life, it's not up to God. It's up to you and I to be a people that are constantly getting filled and recharged and refreshed at the feet of Jesus. Now, we all probably do that differently. I know that we do. But it is my responsibility to fan the flame. It is my responsibility to throw the kindling on the fire. It is my responsibility to go and park at the feet of Jesus in His Word, in prayer, and continually be filled up, because we know this in life as Christians. We're constantly giving out. Life is draining. Life just sucks the energy out of you. I mean, we're giving and we're being drained. And we've got to go back to the feet of Jesus and continually get replenished and refreshed and refilled by His Spirit. Amen? So that's what we've been talking about in different ways every Sunday since the beginning of February. And here's what we know. When we go to God, when we take that time, no matter if it's 15 minutes or 50 minutes, it's not about, what is it? It's not about quantity, it's about quality. All right? Don't get under some kind of legalism. But when we take that time, however precious that time is, and you spend time at the feet of Jesus, He will not only refill your tank, He will renew your passion, and He will recharge your spirit. Amen? Let me just tell you this, church. The best thing that you and I can do when you got nothing left in the tank is to find yourself very quickly at the feet of Jesus. That's the best thing that you and I can do, is park in the Word and park at His feet and let Him refresh you. Amen? If Jesus needed it, you and I need it. Hello. If the Son of God in man body needed the refreshing of the Lord, needed those times, then you and I need them too. We talked about that last week. Over the last couple weeks, I've been drilling down personally on this subject because I've been getting a little frustrated in a good way. There's a good frustration, there's bad frustration, and I've been getting frustrated because I've been asking God a question. I'm a question guy. It's not wrong to question God as long as you're looking to Him for the answer. And I've been questioning, like, God, there's got to be something more. Something's missing. And I know that every word He's given me is from His heart and for us. But I just was going there, and I was just doing a lot of thinking, a lot of writing, and a lot of praying, and a lot of talking to my wife and a couple of pastor friends. And about a week ago, the Holy Spirit, in one of those times, just like, God, I know there's got to be a reason that so many of God's people, there's got to be something more why they're running on empty. Why is it? And the Holy Spirit whispered to me, and this is what I want to talk to you about today. It was so clear it came to me. He said, son, my children have lost their enthusiasm for me. My children have lost their enthusiasm for me. Enthusiasm. Some people may call it passion or fire, but that's actually not what it is. Enthusiasm will actually feed those things. And I heard very specific the word enthusiasm. So this is going to be very fresh for me and for you. I've never actually spoke a message on enthusiasm in all these years of ministry. I've spoken on passion and fire a whole bunch. But I want us to kind of real quick look at the definition in the dictionary of enthusiasm. And this is it right here. Enthusiasm is showing an intense and eager enjoyment, interest, or approval. It's showing intense and eager enjoyment, interest, or approval. Leave that up there for just a moment. All of us are enthused about things. All of us, if you were to drill down and talk with people, there's some things that you're very enthusiastic about. So this is not a new word, but we're going to drill down in a moment and look at the historical word coming from the Greek and see what God says about it. But enthusiasm, I mean, some people are very, I mean, we're in a state like much like Alabama that doesn't have a pro team, so many people in the state are very, and like any state that doesn't have a pro team, they're very enthusiastic about sports. All right, I don't think I've ever met such a crazy people to go watch a volleyball game. I went to see the Cornhuskers in the volleyball game a year ago, and I was like, these people are crazy, you know, over volleyball, you know. But that's awesome. It's fun, you know, but definitely football, you know, and where I come from in the South. But there's also all kinds of things. There are some people that are enthusiastic about card games, and there are some people that are, my grandfather used to be very, when he was alive, was enthusiastic about chess. He just loved it. He ate it up. Some people, heaven forbid, are enthusiastic about math. I don't know how, but there are those rare individuals from another planet, you know, that they just love math. They love doing math. Math oozes from them. We're enthusiastic as parents about our children. You become a grandparent, you become even more enthusiastic about children. And so there's many things. This is not a new word. We all have rhythms of life that we're enthusiastic about. Emerson said this, Ralph Waldo Emerson, he said, a nothing great was ever achieved without enthusiasm. When you and I do something enthusiastically, you do it with excitement and eagerness. Anything that you love, anything that you put your heart and soul in, you might express that excitement differently because we're individuals, but you put your heart and soul into it, you're excited about it, especially the final product, whatever that is, it's enthusiastic. You're enthusiastic about it. But here's the deal. When you dive a little deeper into this word enthusiasm, it means a lot more than just passionate interest. I'm going to look at my notes here because this is some deep stuff here. Enthusiasm comes from the Greek word enthusiasmos, meaning, check this out, to be possessed by God. to be possessed by God. We were just singing about that earlier. It's the word enthos, all right, Greek, in God, enthusiasm, enthos, theos being God, in God. So in its root concept, when you drill down the word enthusiasm, it means God within us or full of God. Hello. God within us or full of God. Let me just tell you this, church, we're all full of something. Hello. We need to be full of God. Can I get an amen? Listen, we got to recognize this. God is not, and I know we know this, but I need to say this again. We were just singing about it earlier. God is not in some far galaxy, far, far away from us. When you and I asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, when you asked Him to come into your life and be your Savior, His Holy Spirit came in to dwell within us. We were born again. His Spirit came to, that blows my mind, to dwell in me, and I became a new person. We are, the Scriptures tell us, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Christ, the hope of glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Let me just tell you, that it doesn't get any closer than that. Someone living in you. We are a living, breathing, moving temple. We're His vessels. We're His vehicles. We're His hands and feet. I don't know about you, but when I think about that, you and I were purchased. Think about that. You and I were purchased by His blood. Jen just led us in that old familiar hymn. Purchased. God purchased you by His Son. I was purchased by Jesus. As a wretch, as filthy, as yuck, as selfish, all that, Jesus purchased me. He said, that boy is mine. That girl is mine. They're mine. I'm possessed by God. He possessed me. I'm bought. He bought me with a hefty price, His own blood. He gave me His Holy Spirit. Say a few things that we all know. He, not only that, He will never leave me nor forsake me. No matter what I go through, when people will leave you, He will never leave you. Listen, if some of you were abandoned in different situations in life, He will never abandon you. He's not only with you, He's for you. And He's in you by His Holy Spirit. Man. And because of what He did for me, you and I can live in victory. See, those statements, that was all Bible, by the way. Those statements I just said, that fills my spirit so much with excitement when I think about those things. When I think about what He's done for me, I get really, really excited. My heart gets filled up. I get joyful. I get enthusiastic about it. You remember that song we learned as kids? And I'm so happy, so very happy. What does it say? I've got the love of Jesus in my... I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. That's what makes me happy. We're not talking about the world's happiness that fades, that's maybe high today and low tomorrow. We're talking about a true joy that is found in Jesus Christ. I've got a river deep down in me flowing. A river of joy flowing in me. I love this scripture, Romans 12, 11, right here on the screen. We're going to go to 2 Samuel in just a second. Out of the Passion Translation, it says this, be enthusiastic to serve the Lord, keeping your passion toward Him, come on, say it with me, boiling hot. Ooh. Be enthusiastic to serve the Lord. You can't even say that kind of boring, can you? It's like, keep your passion toward Him boiling hot. It just doesn't work. Be enthusiastic to serve the Lord. Keep your passion toward Him. Come on, say it with me. Boiling hot. I love this. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit. And let Him fill you with excitement as you serve him. Can I tell you what? There is no greater high, there is no greater thrill, there is no greater excitement than serving the Lord Jesus. There's nothing. There's no drug, there's no drink, there's nothing that can even come close to serving my Jesus. He is the ultimate best of everything. There are no words in my vocabulary to be able to express all that. If you're taking notes, the person, let's hear me on this. The person who is full, somebody say full. The person who is full of the Holy Spirit is never lacking in enthusiasm. So we've got to be a people that we continually run back to the well, that's our Father, go back to the well that never runs dry and continually stay fresh, stay full of the Spirit. I'm telling you, life will wear you out. It will beat you down. And we're not even talking about spiritual warfare. So you got just life itself that gets us caught up in busyness and everything else, and then you got all hell fighting against you and I. Because hell does not want you to stay fresh. Hell wants you to be drained. Hell wants you to be empty. Hell wants you to be, you got nothing left. Are you with me this morning? The person who is full of the Holy Spirit is never lacking enthusiasm. The most joyful, fulfilled people that Lisa and I know are those who live with a true enthusiasm for Jesus. And some of them are extroverts and some of them are introverts. Enthusiasm has nothing to do with the personality of a person. These people that I look up to so much and I have so much respect for, they carry within themselves a great faith and expectation for life because of that enthusiasm they have for Jesus. Because why? Enthusiastic Christians find their inspiration and their purpose for life in Christ, not in anything else. I want to say that again. Enthusiastic Christians find their inspiration and purpose for life in Christ and nothing else. In Christ and Christ alone. Amen? There are no substitutes, people. There are no substitutes. It's Jesus and Jesus alone. And sadly, many of God's people, and I've been there before, we've probably all been there, have lost their enthusiasm for the Lord. And it's simply, I believe, because our lives are so full of so many other things. Pastor Jermaine preached a great message several months ago about making more room for Jesus in our lives. The main thought of this whole series is this right here on the screen. While our lives have never been fuller, our souls have never been emptier. Church, it's so easy. For me, I'm just a man. Any of us, we just can get so caught up in this life, can't we? We can just get so caught up in this life and filling up our life with things. And things are not bad in of itself, but if we're just filling up our life with all this stuff and we have no time or room for Jesus, then those things are actually wrong. We've got to make sure that first and foremost that we make Jesus the center of our lives, that we seek him with all of our heart, we seek his kingdom first, and then we know that everything else will just fall into place. Church, we make God too hard. Let's just be real for a moment. We make God too hard. He says if we will seek him first and we will seek his kingdom and his righteousness, he says he'll take care of everything else. That's it. He says, just seek me, Chris. Just seek me, seek my kingdom, seek righteousness, right living, and I'll take care of your family, I'll take care of your finances, I'll take care of your future, I'll take care of everything. But what we try to do is take care of everything and then have a little bit left for God. And we've got it all mixed up. If we just will chase after God. Look, I know we've got some young people in the room. I've told young people for years, if you will just chase after God, you don't have to go hunting for any woman or any man. You just chase after God. And before you know it, there's going to be somebody chasing right next to you. You just be running like chasing after God like, oh, hello. And you just keep running. That's the way it was with me. I'm telling you. I regretfully, some of you know this, I shared it when I first got here, I regretfully played the dating game in my high school years and in my college years. And when I finally surrendered to the Lord at 19, I mean, I surrendered all, everything, my heart, including what I'm talking about. And I went to Bible college. I told the Lord, driving to Texas, I cried from Alabama, my driveway, all the way to the Mississippi line. The only reason I stopped crying is because there was nothing left of my tear ducts. All right, literally, I could not cry. And because I would surrender it to God, and I'm going to this crazy unknown state where they say nothing, everything is bigger in Texas, and you know, all the, this is a prideful state, very prideful state. And you know, just going there, and I mean, I can say all this. Lisa's not watching, and she probably won't watch the message later either. I'm about to break pride off her when she gets home. You know, but the fact of the matter is, I'm kidding. If you can't have fun in church, come on, where can you have fun? But the fact of the matter is, you know, I got there and I said, Lord, that's it. My heart is yours. And from the day I made that commitment to the Lord, I met my wife. I didn't know her at the time, was my wife, a year later. And instead of chasing all these things and having no room for God, I just chased him, and he brought my best friend to me. Instead of me hunting, I found. I'm using one particular personal story, but that's the way it is in life. We are doing all these things, and we're all this stuff, and all that stuff is not bad, and there's things that you and I have to do as parents or grandparents, as a job, and we got to do all these things. But what if we did all those things from a place of fullness in God instead of coming to God with nothing left all the time? Now look, there are those times. Aren't you glad he doesn't kick you to the curb when you do feel empty and dry? I mean, thank God. He's like, no, get out of here. You know, you come back to me full. Well, that's why I'm coming to you in the first place. You know, like, but the fact of the matter is, he never will kick you to the curb, but we shouldn't use that as an excuse. We need to be people that are constantly going to the well and be full of the Spirit of God. And this is what I know about enthusiasm. When you are full of God, you can't help but be enthusiastic about him. However you express that is different, but you cannot help but be enthusiastic about Jesus if you are fully in love with him and full of his Spirit. But I have found in my life, when my enthusiasm begins to wane or drop altogether, is when I become consumed with life instead of being consumed with him. And I've let life weigh me down instead of giving him over everything I'm feeling. And that's the plan of the enemy. Is for life just to beat you down and you feel so empty. You're no good to anybody. I can't do anything. Are you with me? But when you get caught up and focused in Christ and Christ alone and you seek him, seek his kingdom, he tells us everything else will just fall into place. I love this quote from Dr. Bill Wilson. He says this, and then we're going to 2 Sam. When our life in Christ, look at this, when our life in Christ flows out of a personal relationship that defines everything about us. Oh my. When our life in Christ flows out of a personal relationship that defines everything about us and gives us a center to build the rest of a life around, enthusiasm is inevitable. When you make Christ the center of everything, you can't help but be joyful. You can't help but be eager to serve. You can't help but to be enthusiastic. When my kids were little, and I'm telling you, I don't envy parents when their kids are little for many reasons, mainly because of lack of sleep. But the Lord showed me one time, you have made your kids a god. You have made them your life. And you need to give your kids back to me. And it could be anything. It could be money. It could be material. It could be whatever. For me, it was my kids. And I'm telling you, I had to give marriage, whatever, give that to the Lord. And so we've got to recognize and understand that everything has to be centered around Jesus and Jesus alone. Here's what we know about enthusiasm. Enthusiasm can be seen, felt, and heard. Why? Because enthusiasm in of itself is very contagious. I want us to look, if we can, in 2 Samuel chapter 6. Are you there? Am I making sense this morning? I hope so. Now, this is a story. David's one of my heroes in the Bible. And David was known as a man after God's own heart. He was a worshiper. He had a uniqueness. You know, he wrote, 85% of the Psalms. And, boy, you read those Psalms. I live in Psalms a lot. And but here's a story. It's an interesting story. That David had tried to bring the ark back to the city of David, back to Jerusalem, and they had done it all wrong, and so they left the ark at a guy's house named Obed-Edom, the ark representing the presence of the Lord. And many of you maybe know this story, but let's see what God speaks to us fresh on this. And then it says, look down at verse 12 because of time. Then King David was told, "The Lord has blessed Obed-Edom's household and everything he has because of the ark of God." So David went there and brought the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with great celebration. How many people know our God is worth celebrating? Amen? Thank you, two of you. Okay, he's worth celebrating. I know you're with me. Verse 13, after the men who were carrying the ark of the Lord had gone six steps, David sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf, and they did that all the way there. That was a long day of celebration. But they were doing it the right way at that time. Verse 14, and David danced before the Lord with all of his might, wearing a priestly garment. So David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of ram's horn. Verse 16, but as the ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, I hope I'm saying that right, the daughter of Saul, looked down from her window. When she saw her husband, by the way, when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she was filled with contempt for him. She saw him no longer worthy. Verse 17, then they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in the place inside the special tent David had prepared for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. Verse 18, when he had finished his sacrifices, David blessed the people in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies. And then he gave to every Israelite man, look at this, then he gave to every Israelite man and woman a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins. So the people went home full with lots of cake. You can't go wrong with cake. Then all the people returned to their homes. Now, this is interesting. Verse 20, when David returned home to bless his own family. So David was returning home. He's blessed all the people. It is his intention now to go home after a wonderful day of celebration of bringing the Ark of God back to Jerusalem. David's intention is to go bless his family. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him. And she said in disgust, "How distinguished the king of Israel looked today, shamelessly exposing himself to the servant girls like any vulgar person might do." David retorted to Michal, I love this, "I was dancing before the Lord, who chose me above your father and all his family. He appointed me as the leader of Israel, the people of the Lord, so I celebrate before the Lord." Church, can I tell you, stay right there, keep your finger right there, but we need to recognize, understand, whether it's worship in here corporately or it's worship the way we live our lives, that we do everything unto the Lord. And when we do everything unto the Lord, we do it with enthusiasm, we do it with excellence, because He's a King and He deserves the very best. Amen? So that means if you're right at the first job flipping burgers, you're the best burger flipper in the world. You're doing it as worship unto the Lord. Whatever you're doing, wherever you're at work, you're not doing it for the boss. The Bible even tells us this. You're not working for man. You're working for the Lord. The Lord is the one who gives you the paycheck. It may say that person's company's name on it, but the Lord is the one who's providing you. So we are working for Him, and He deserves our very best. He's a King. He deserves the best. So David is saying, I didn't do this for anybody. I was dancing before the Lord. I am celebrating the Lord. And then he throws a little jab in there, you know, and says, "He chose me over your daddy." But the fact is, he's saying, and it's something we need to remember, that it's all unto the Lord. So there are times that you might come into corporate worship, or even, I don't want to go to a prayer meeting, or come to, and let me tell you something, let me just be real. Sometimes your pastor doesn't want to go to a prayer meeting. Sometimes in coming to worship Sunday morning, I don't feel like it. But then I think, wait a minute, worship's not about me. Prayer is not about me. It's about God. I'm going to do everything I can to give Him my best because He deserves my best. He's my King. And look what He's done for me. I'm just talking about me, what He's done for you. Does He not deserve our best in every way? For me in worship, whether it's the hymns or whether it's contemporary worship songs. I get lost in His presence. I just think about everything He's done for me, and I can't help with my hands and my heart, and I blow out my voice sometimes, just lifting everything to Him. I mean, when we get to heaven, someone said this a long time ago, when we get to heaven, two things are going to happen. First off, we're all going to fall on our face when we see Jesus. Just fall down on our face, like John. Secondly, when we finally have the strength enough to get up in our new body, come on, somebody, we're going to have a new body. Pastor Jermaine just read about it. New body, thank you, Lord. All right, no death, no decay. Muscles everywhere, all right? Perfect body. When we get up off that ground, and we get the strength enough to look Jesus, I'm telling you, for those who have never danced before the Lord, you will dance in that moment. With such joy, for all that you lived in your life, there is your Savior looking at you. And the Bible even says in Zephaniah 3:17, when He thinks about us, He dances around us with joy in songs. Who do you even think gave you any rhythm in your body at all? It came from the Lord. Somebody's like, Pastor Chris, I am white. There is no rhythm in my body. I understand that. All right? But I'm talking, that's why He said for us to make a joyful noise. He said just to worship Him with all of our heart. And David is doing this, and he doesn't care. And he's in these crazy kingly garments, and he's just dancing before God. And probably because of man, with some of the people were making fun of him, he didn't care. He was giving God his all. Now, we're not telling you next Sunday to come in your garments, in your pajamas. That's not the point of this. The point of this is for you and I to give God our all. Worship is not about 30 minutes or 35 minutes on a Sunday morning. I think it's even more important that we worship God Monday through Saturday with our lives. He's the King. He deserves my best. And can I tell you, when I do that, it's a sweet-smelling fragrance to Him. When I don't complain, but I praise. When I work my tail off, but I'm not recognized by the boss. When people are talking about my back, and I just pray, all those things that happen to you and I, we just choose in that moment, God, I'm going to work my tail off. I'm going to do everything I can for you, not for man, because everything you've done for me. And everything I do on this earth doesn't even come close for what you did to me and for me. Amen? And it says right here, yes, I am willing. Verse 22, back there at 2 Samuel. Yes, I'm willing to look. I like how many translations say, even more undignified than this. And New Living puts it pretty blunt too. I am willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. Why? Because I'm doing it unto the Lord. But those servant girls you mentioned, by the way, will indeed think I'm distinguished. And this is why you got to be really careful what you say about people. So Michal, the daughter of Saul, remained childless throughout her entire life. I want to share something with you before we bring this to a close. And this is going to kind of go into a two-parter here. But stay with me. Being a Southern boy and being from a state that doesn't have a pro team, of course, as I said earlier, everything was about the Crimson Tide. We don't know who Auburn is, even though I'm feeling bad for them today. And all friends, thank you. There's prayer for you in the back. But the fact of the matter is, at least my dad and I would save up some money and we would go see an Atlanta Falcon game, because in the South, a lot of people pulled for the Falcons, even though they had years and years of losing seasons. And so as I had that memory, I did it with my boys. And many years ago, I took my oldest son, Nicholas, who's back helping with the kids today, and we went to see the Falcons-Panthers game, and it was the last game of the season, and whoever won was in the playoffs, and whoever was out was out, eliminated. And I mean, when I walked into that huge dome, the Georgia Dome, it's no longer there. They have a new building now. It was pandemonium. It was electric. It was crazy. We finally got our seats, got some pretty good seats, surrounded by strangers, and everybody start. The game starts, and here, just fast forwarding, the last 2 minutes, Atlanta is losing by 10 points. There's a point of reason I'm telling you all this. And somehow, craziness, in less than 2 minutes, Atlanta comes back and wins the game. I mean, the roof was going, it was just going to blow off. People are going nuts. me and Nicholas are yelling and screaming. I've got no voice left. I mean, and the people that were strangers were all hugging each other. I don't drink beer, but beer was all over me because people were doing all this, you know, popcorn everywhere. I mean, people are going crazy. All the Panther fans, you know, they were all just leaving, going down the stairs, you know, and everybody's nah, 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 hey. I mean, doing all that. I mean, it was crazy. And no one wanted to leave. I mean, it was nuts. And it was crazy. And I mean, it was so bad that I remember leaving, my ears were ringing. You ever been to a game or like in a building where it's, you know, my ears were ringing. And, but in that moment of celebration, it was like everything went quiet just for a second. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And I wish he would do this every day. I don't get it a whole bunch. He speaks to me a lot of times through his word. But here and there I get these, what I call God interruptions. And I kid you not, everything went quiet for a moment. And I knew what it was. I felt a ringing in my ear. And I knew it wasn't my ears. It was the Spirit speaking to me. And he said to me in that moment, I want my church, my children, to be this excited for me in their life. And it so spoke to me that when I went home, my son asked me twice, Dad, are you okay? Because like it was, I mean, it was a thrill. I mean, my Falcons were going to playoffs the next week. They lost. But I mean, they were going in, you know. But it shook me. And this was early on. My son was like 5 years old. And I told the Lord that night when I got home, my little 3-hour drive back home. I told the Lord that night when I put everybody to bed, it was just me and him. I said, I will never let anything, sports, my family, anything, I will never let anything get more of my energy than you. Lord, if I'm never in the ministry again, at that time I was leading the school, if I'm never in the ministry again, and I was doing ministry, we're all in ministry by the way, hello, but if I'm never in full-time ministry again, Father, Lord, I want to make sure that I live my life, that you get my utmost. You get my all. You get my everything. Enthusiasm. Amen? Listen to me, last few minutes. Somewhere along the way, we have lost our enthusiasm for the Lord. I asked them to do Blessed Assurance this morning for the specific reason that we all have a story. And that story's not over yet. And God's doing great things in our lives, and he's done great things. I don't know about you, but I don't know if you remember when it was that you gave your heart to Jesus Christ. Do you remember that joy and that peace and that just that fire that was burning in you that was uncontrollable? I'm afraid today the church has controllable fire. And can I tell you about controllable fire? It will eventually go out. This is not, again, some introvert, extrovert, loud, or quiet thing. This is a matter of the heart. Because whatever is in your heart is eventually going to come out into your life. I'm a husband. Well, first I'm a son, then I'm a husband, then I'm a father, and then I'm a pastor. That's the way I see it. And can I just tell you this? More than anything, I, as a leader of the home, I say that humbly before God. He calls me the priest of my home. That I want my wife and my children to see a man imperfect as he is, but that is ablaze for Jesus. In my imperfections, in my faults, and this week a couple times, I lost, you know, my temper. I told you I wanted to kill him a couple times. It was just me and them. And I had to tell my son, I'm so sorry I lost my temper. Please forgive me. You know, like, that's okay. I mean, those things happen. But amongst all that, I want my sons to see, as imperfect as I am, my dad chases after Jesus. I have great memories of seeing my dad and my mom praying individually. And now when we go and visit them, which is very, you know, doesn't happen a whole bunch, I love waking up in their home and I go outside and I see them on the swing now that they're retired, swinging on the porch early in the morning with their coffee, just talking to Jesus. My mom's still serving. My dad's still serving in their late 70s now, going after Jesus. It's not an age thing. It's a heart thing. That's why we can't put down young people. It says, do not let anybody despise youth. And that's why we don't disrespect older people, who I call the mamas and papas. We need them all. And all, no matter how young or old we are, we should be enthusiastic about Jesus because of what he's done for us. And this world will choke all that out. Yes, suffocate it if we're not careful. It's a heart thing. Colossians 3:23 says this, "And whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not men." And whatever you do, that pretty much encompasses everything. Whatever you do, do it heartily. Do it with all your heart. I looked it up. That was heart and soul. Do it with your heart and soul. Do it unto the Lord and not to men. But I'm afraid many Christians are more concerned about what men think than what God thinks. And can I tell you, church, that's a quick way to extinguish the fire of God burning in your heart. God has never called us to be men pleasers. We're God pleasers. Amen? Last thought. A true enthusiasm for the Lord. This is what I truly believe. A true enthusiasm for the Lord is not something that can be contained, restrained, or held back. I have never told a person in my life to calm down in their fire for God. If anything, I've encouraged people, let it keep burning, let it keep burning. I've told young people for years, please don't grow up out of the fire of God in your heart. Don't grow up with everything that happens and become so churchified and so religious that you got no joy in your life. And that's for us. I read article after article this week of young adults between the ages of 18 to 30 who have visited churches in the last couple of years. This was not local stuff. I mean, I guess it could have been, but it was all over. I was reading it. And the one thing they all kept saying was, is this it? Is this it? Like, is this it? Is this what you're talking about? And I don't know the type of churches that they visited, and we bless every church here that loves Jesus. Amen. But the fact of the matter is, I believe there's a generation that is right behind mine that is looking at the church and saying, is this it? Is this the thing I should be doing? Is this it? Is this what I should be emulating? Is this what I should be pursuing? What the way you're living? Is this what you're telling me to do? And I'm telling you, we've got to be a people that if we say we're in love with Jesus, we are in love with Jesus. That we say that we worship Jesus, we are worshiping Jesus 7 days a week. That we are living for him to the fullest because of what he's done. That we are possessed by God. That he owns us and we're unashamed of that. And that people, when they get around us, they see not just the, you know, the sparkle in the eye. No, they see more than that. They see light. They experience the presence of God. Come on, God wants to show up more than just on Sunday. He wants to show up in your life every day, every hour, in every person that we come in contact with. We've got to recognize this and understand this. Last point right here, Romans 12:1. And I love the way that the Message puts it as we close. Worship team, you can come on forward. How do we do this? Well, the answer is in Romans 12, whatever translation you read. But Romans 12:1, it says this. So here's what I want you to do. God helping you. Take your everyday, somebody say everyday. Take your everyday, ordinary life. You're sleeping, you're eating, you're going to work, you're walking around life. Just life. Somebody say life. And place it before God as an offering. Take everything, the way you live your life. You're sleeping, you're eating, you're going to work, you're walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. And I love this. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Amen. Church, more than anything else, I want to encourage you. I'm not asking you to be me. Thank God there's only one Chris Frith in this world. My mic's been just falling off, so forgive me for messing with it today. But what I believe God is asking for us to be is all in for him. for everything he did for me, I want to reciprocate that. And I want to live with an enthusiasm. And I have never believed in all my life, because I've seen it modeled from my grandparents to my parents to great men and women, elders that I've known through the years that I call still for counsel and respect. And there's a fire in them in their 60s, and there's an enthusiasm about life in their 70s. And though they may not be able to move around like they could in their 80s, man, you get around them and you hear the stories and you hear the life, and it just oozes from them. And I'm like, man, I gotta have me some of that. And can I tell you what that is the Holy Spirit and the fire of God and the enthusiasm for Him and for life. I believe that when people see us, they should want what we have. When they come to church, they should say, I don't know what all this is, but I gotta have me some of that. That we are the life-giving people because the life-giver lives in us. There is nothing else that can fill people up. That's why millionaires and billionaires end their lives with these notes of, I was so empty. Because nothing else will fill but Jesus Christ. There is no substitute. God, I believe with all my heart, He wants us, it's not Him, He wants us to reclaim our enthusiasm for Him. He wants us to reclaim our enthusiasm. Dee, would you mind and share that real quick, if you would? Dee, share it. I have a microphone right there with you, Pastor Jermaine. As we were praying in prayer, Dee, one of our leaders in the church, we were just praying for you guys in the side prayer room, and she was just praying this out. And if anything, if it's just a prayer, you just pray it. But I'm telling you, we've got to, it's a choice. It's not God, it's a choice. I have to choose to walk in that joy. Because this big bad world that we're about to walk out these doors and go, there's a lot of stuff in there that will steal your joy real quick. All kind of stuff that will steal your joy. And in that moment, and you might get a phone call this afternoon, not a very joyful phone call. All kinds of things can happen. Sorrowful, painful stuff. We're not denying the reality of that. But in that moment, we choose the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen. The joy of our salvation. So I want us to pray together. Dee, would you mind just sharing your heart for a moment?
Sure. This morning, as we were praying, Pastor Chris, of course, was talking about his message and this message of enthusiasm. And as I was hearing what he was saying, it came to me that many times we get so under everything that goes on in our life every day. Just like he said about a word, maybe from a doctor, or this coming from that, or finances, or losses, or whatever, and we lose our joy. We just lose our joy, and it just becomes a burden. Everything is about what's going on, and sometimes we just can't get out of that. The thing that came to my mind this morning was that this enthusiasm, we're talking about the joy of the Lord is our strength. And, you know, it is. The joy of the Lord is our strength. But most of the time, we're saying, but I don't feel that joy of the Lord. I don't have that joy of the Lord. I'm too down. I'm too under it. Life is too heavy. It's too big. There's too much going on. I don't know how to be joyful. The word that came to me is we can't get joyful. There's no way we can just be joyful, but we can be enthusiastic, and we can reach out to the Lord and say, you know, I want your joy. I want that fire back in me. But that's a choice. That's a choice, because when we're under everything, it is so easy to be downhearted. Our heads hang. Our step becomes slow. We're tired. We're worn out. And I get that. I understand that. We all do.
Been there, done it.
You bet. We're all tired and we're all worn out. We can get worn out. But if we want the joy of the Lord to be manifested in our life, then we have to step out in that. We have to look higher than that. Lord, I want what you have for me. I want that enthusiasm back. And so how do I do that? I step into it. I just step into it. I choose not to let that have the final say in my life.
Right. That's right.
Because it can have the final say in our life, right?
That's right. That's right.
And we walk around with that heaviness. God does not want that for
us.
Things may not change, but I tell you what, many times when we don't think life is going to change, if we step into this, if we choose not to let it have power over us.
That's right.
Because believe me, the enemy will take it.
Yeah.
He will take that burden. He will take that heaviness. And he will manifest it to the place to where we just cannot come out of it.
Right.
We don't have to go there.
That's right.
It doesn't have to be that way.
Yeah.
We can choose.
That's right.
We can choose to look at our situations different.
Yeah.
We can choose to let the Lord have his way in our hearts.
Yeah.
And in that, when we choose to do that, enthusiasm will rise in
That's
our
right.
heart.
That's right.
Joy will come back in our spirit. And we will begin to have a light in our face.
Amen.
Where we were dreary, now we're going to be excited.
Amen.
So I just want to share with you.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dean. Come on, let's stand together. Please don't right now, this moment. But that's where I'm going, Larry, and I think we all need to do this right now. If you're here today in this place, right where you're standing, as we worship the Lord together, and you need to reclaim that enthusiasm for the Lord and that joy, somebody say joy. That's what it is, that you're literally before God saying, God, I may not be able to change my circumstances, but I can change the way I look at my circumstances. I may not be able to change what's going on in my life, but God, I can change my attitude by surrendering to you. So if you're here today, and guess what? We've all been there, done that. So you're not alone. You're not by yourself. Whatever, wherever you're at in life, if you want to reclaim that enthusiasm starting today, we're not talking about some magic wand or you feel goosebumps. We're talking about you making a choice in Jesus' name to say, God, I choose you. I choose your joy and the enthusiasm for you and for life, so that I can be all that you call me to be. If that's you, ask to simply raise your hand across this room, sons and daughters of the King. Lord, I want my joy back. I'm not going to use excuses. I'm not going to this and that, all this kind of stuff, and real stuff. But God, I want, and for some of you, I believe he wants to restore a song of joy. A song of joy again back to you. Look, I know you've been hurt. I've been hurt. We've all been hurt. But we're not going to let that record just keep playing. We're going to let the joy of the Lord, we're going to let the song of the Lord. Come on, let's worship God together. Sing it all as a church. This is my story.
This is my story.
Come on, church, tell him.
This is my song.
This is my story. Church, let's just tell him, God, I thank you. You're changing songs in this place. Not the story of the world, your story. Come on, sing it by faith.
Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my song.
a wonderful Savior. Lord, you're a wonderful Savior. Come on, just tell him in your own way. God, you're a wonderful Savior.
Oh, what Jesus. A Savior, wonderful Jesus. Oh, what a Savior, wonderful Jesus.
Oh, what a Savior.
Oh, what a Savior, wonderful Jesus. 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 Death could not hold you. You are victorious. Grace to the risen King.
One last time. Death could not hold you. Right where you're at, just lift your heart to him. Father, in this place, we use your sons and daughters. We're not using excuses, God. It's just easy. It's easy to get out of it. It's easy, Father God, to sing the woe is me's. It's easy to let life beat us down. But God, because of what your son did for us, we're victorious. We're the head and not the tail. We're overcomers. We're victorious. We're not defeated. No matter how we feel, we don't stand on what we feel. We stand on your word. We stand on your victory. We stand on what your blood did for us. And so, Father, in Jesus' name, we reclaim what is ours, the joy of the Lord. We reclaim it, oh God. And we choose, somebody say choose. We choose to rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. We choose not to look to the left or the right. We choose to focus in on you and you alone. When we hear bad reports, yes, we're going to hear it, but then we're going to turn it to you, God, and praise you in the midst of it. Lord, I pray you would begin to change perspectives, the way we look at things, the way we see things, oh God. We would not look through the lens of discouragement. We would look through the lens of joy and faith and expectation. Father, I believe enthusiasm is a response. So, Father, in Jesus' name, would you break off your people disappointment today, discouragement today in Jesus' name. God, I declare life over your people. You said, I came to give you life and that abundantly. And we are your agents of life. We are your bringers of life, that everywhere we go, we carry life with us, God. What are you carrying that's not of God? Unloaded into the arms of Jesus. Lord, whatever's not of you, we don't want it in Jesus' name. We unload those things to you, Father God. And we thank you, Lord, for your sweet presence. We thank you, Father, for the joy that is found in you. We thank you for the strength that is found in you. And we praise you, God, for this time together. Thank you, Lord, that our story is not yet over. And no matter what people have said about us, no matter what things have happened to us, Lord, we live our lives based on your story for us. And we thank you, Jesus, in your name. And God's people said, amen. Amen. Come on, can we give Jesus a big old thank you? Thank you, Lord God. Hey, listen, I just want to say this as we go. Pastor Jermaine will be in the back with for any further our guest. But listen, this is a grace gift for me. I think every person has a grace gift. And I'd love to pray for some people. And if you're just really wanting that enthusiasm,
I just would love to pray over you and just speak the blessings and the fire and the life of God over you. That's something that I've carried in my life, and I try my best to do it. And so if you're just struggling with disappointment, discouragement, those are two things I kept hearing. I would love to pray over you. Our altar team will be up here with me to pray. But if you want that, we'd love to pray with you. Speaking of prayer, come join us tonight if you can at 6 o'clock. God bless you. Have a wonderful Jesus week. We love each and every one of you.
Shines for all to you.